Yeah, what's up? This is Big Mareko representing the Sip the Cars, South Auckland. Yeah, and I'm meeting Gallo and B Supo with Bass FM. Yeah.
But yo, welcome back to Bass Breakfast. We've got some special guests on the other line up here. We've got Mareko and Ricky Paul Muzik. How are we going?
What's up,
man? We're doing a bit of one of these like Google Zoom calls because you're both in different locations, eh? Like, Mareko, you're over in Aussie, eh?
Yeah, I'm in beautiful sunny Brisbane, Queensland.
So, hey, how long have you been over here, man?
Bro, for about 12 years now.
Far out.
Yeah, so I'm pretty much like almost a third of my life. Yeah.
And what made you what was the move over there? Was it music related or was it kind of just...
Yeah, semi related. One of my mates was a DJ in one of the clubs here, one of the big R&B clubs. And the culture here is different. They had live MCs in the R&B and hip hop clubs here.
Oh, yep.
So he was like, bro, come over, do this gig, man. It pays good money. So I was like, oh, yo. So I've been here ever since.
Yeah. And you're still up in Panade?
No, I moved to Melbourne.
Hey.
Yeah. Possibly about 3 months ago. Oh, no, actually, it's about five, bro. Time's going so quick. I got married. Oh, so great. My wife, during the whole lockdown stuff or just coming out of, so I got married, and then my wife wanted to be close to her family. So that was part of the compromise. Yeah.
So yeah. But by the sounds of it, it's not like slowing down.
Yeah.
Even your output in terms of music, right? Like, take that while I want to talk to you guys today. Was got a new project along the way, Untitled One, out of the trilogy. You know, they talk a little bit more about that. Like, yeah, how's your because when was this? They've both been in different locations. Like, had you kind of form this sort of duo for this project? Like, how did that kind of come to be?
Oh, Richie, you can share your side.
Yeah. I first hooked up with Ricky for this other project that we're doing. You hear about that very soon, eh, Rick? And I don't even really know of this guy's accomplishments and his accolades until we connected through this other project, and he showed me some of his beats, and I was blown away, eh? Just the quality and the professionalism of how he worked. So I was like, bro, flipping. After hearing his or doing some stuff for his Golden Era project, I was like, man, bro, your beats are too dope. Let's do a project. And that was sort of the brainchild of this whole situation we're in now.
Sweet. And was it the Golden Era kind of collaborations with those some of your first sort of collaborations together? Or was it kind of this other project that's yet to be named or talked about?
The Golden Era was the first time that Mareko and I had linked via social media and stuff, and to get him on his own track, but then also it all initiated because of their top five NZ track.
Oh, yeah.
Him, Savage, Scribe, and all them. Yeah. So my story is exactly the same as his. So we're working on another project. And
should we just name the project, bro?
What is this project?
We'll just put it out there. We're gonna be pushing it soon anyway. We're finishing the final Decepticons album.
Oh wow!
With myself, Savage, the whole gang, Devolo, Alphrus, and Ricky plays a massive part in that project. I think he's got half of the album locked up on there.
Wow! And that's only the first release since 2010. The last album of.
It's the 20th year anniversary this year, so the narrative is perfect. We released in 2002, Elimination.
Okay.
So a whole heap has happened since in those 20 years, and this is sort of the bookend of that whole chapter about Decepticons' career. But man, the album's sounding dope.
Yeah.
It's good to hear Savage spitting again. Sav's like actually spitting.
Yeah.
And yeah, it's dope. Ricky will tell you, man, it's me.
And was there like, you know, of course you kind of have like different like sort of like collaborative efforts in between those, like the last Decepticons release and now. But how, about it, like how's that feel in terms of having a project on the way of all your brothers together?
Oh man, it feels awesome. Like the camaraderie of like putting the music back together again, and just having the freedom of seeing that how far we've matured, and bringing that all together in the studio, like in the music sense, is awesome. Just working with my brothers again has been dope.
That's awesome.
I think New Zealand really got to appreciate it.
Oh man, looking forward to that for sure.
Yeah, so what happened with this one is it's exactly what Mareko said, but now that you know what album is relaying or referring to, that was meant to be out around mid-year?
Yeah.
July, August, Rex?
Yeah.
Original?
Yeah.
And so what happened was we had done, or they had done basically bulk of the project or selected their beats and all that stuff. It was just the last of the writing from what I know of. And but because of that process, it ended up sort of getting pushed out further. And so in the meantime, Rex said, bro, do you want to do an album? So then my recollection of time frames is I just said, cool, let me sit on some sonic sounds. And then I think this was literally like 3 days in and around my wedding, 3-4 days going into, so I'm under mad pressure with that stuff. And so I cooked up from memory maybe 8-11 beats, and then sent them through, and he kept sending them back very quick too. So I think we had the bulk of the album, if I'm wrong, about a week.
Yeah.
Other than the order and the finer things, I think we had.
Yeah. Where does the meat, where the meat and potatoes, like the good thing about Ricky, because I work fast and Ricky works fast as well, so it was a great pairing.
And what was it, like something about like, you know, Ricky's like production that can like draw you into that?
Yeah, like
well, in terms of the style and the sound, you know.
Yeah, well, the first batch of beats he sent me for the Decogs album was very like it was like semi hip hop. It had a bit of a tinge of commercial sensibilities to it, and I was like, oh yeah, this is dope. But then he told me he was into that underground, like the Griselda guys, and I was like, bro, who is this dude, man? this dude, you know, the stuff that Griselda sound was right up my alley. So it piqued my attention, and he sent me some of those. It's a whole different kind of sound that he sent in the first batch of the Decons album, and I was like, bro, these beats are amazing. And you know, the more I feel the beats, the easier it is for me to write. And that's why we knocked it out so quickly, in about a week and a bit, the bulk.
Yeah, that's amazing. And especially like with that Griselda sound, as you said, like kind of that gritty, grimy, real into, like, in terms of like the lyrical content and what you are saying. And that's kind of what I was going to say about the whole naming of this trilogy, like Untitled Part 1, and it's that there's no sort of like preconception of kind of what the album is. It's more about focused on terms of Bar itself.
Yeah. Definitely.
I think Rick's was real easy on my end too, because the truth is, like, in the New Zealand commercial sense, like an actual producer would generally, like in America, when you've worked with Americans, you run the session.
Yeah.
But in New Zealand, where they, I guess they haven't been exposed to that type of setting, the artists cause a lot of shots. So you don't really end up producing, you end up really just beat making and hope that they enjoy the speed and that it gets used.
Yeah.
So
the transaction.
Also, beat makers don't really know how to produce too. So Record gave me the whole the free will to, because I just sort of started dreaming up the album, the concept, the sound of it all, and he just let me run with it. So I just, right, what do you think of this cover or this, or we'll go for a minimalistic approach, or, but because I think we enjoyed and did part one really, really quick, like in that week or so, he just said, bro, do it, should we do another one? So we made it three, because we did the second batch of beats in like the same time frame, which is a different sound altogether to this one. This one will probably throw, for those who haven't heard it, only those who purchased the vinyl, get your vinyl, Hamish.
I have to. Are we still in the loop? That's what I was going to talk
about. Yeah, we've still got the black and red ones left. But they got to hear it first. There's a privilege of pre-ordering the vinyl, so they've got it, I think, a few weeks before everyone else hears it this Friday. But I think this one will throw, there's some tracks on there where people would expect Mareko to be on that type of buzz, but there are some sounds that you'll hear on there that will sort of throw it a bit left field than what you would think. Everyone will start expecting White Sunday, but it actually has its own sound. But for those who, I guess, find that difficult because they wanted something of White Sunday, Act 2 will definitely cater for that, for sure.
And is that, like, from Mareko, like, in terms of your, like, process of making music, is it, like, how much has it changed in terms of, like, from, you know, talking about White Sunday to all the way to now? Like, you mentioning, like, you know, being quite fast in terms of, like, kind of recording and things like that, but is there other sort of elements in terms of how you kind of, like, pull things together that's kind of changed over the years? Like,
yeah, well, I've pretty much grown up a whole lot more since White Sunday. White Sunday was almost 20 years ago.
Yeah.
And a lot of my, my life has gone down a different path, and I've lived a lot more and matured a lot more. So the stories I'm telling now would be way different to back then, but same sensibilities, same lane as far as like that traditional hip hop sound that I'm accustomed to, or that people accustomed me to. And I don't think I'll ever shake that. It is a well-rounded project, and I think people will appreciate it. Because I really think this is like my second
Wednesday. They have lyrics, even the feedback from those who purchased the vinyl love it.
Yeah. Man, I'm real proud of this because of what we've created. I feel like it's my second wind. I feel like I'm writing the best stuff, honestly, that I've ever written. Just got a love for the culture again, or for rapping.
New lease of life, but a new sense of energy with not only working with Ricky, but just in terms of the sound of the output of the projects.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, and it's also like I've said to some artists before that it's hip hop is really doing a 360 as well. So, like, you see Nas all of a sudden, you know, Alchemist and Freddie Gibbs, they're all getting, you know, Jay Electronica, they're getting the Grammy Awards, other than Kanye, who tanks it with Donda. But in general, they're all going back to the traditional boom bap sound. And so it just really is. DJ Muggs, all these guys are all of a sudden coming back, and there's like another round. Not that it's ever disappeared, it just got covered with all those subgenres of hip hop, but that type of substance stuff will always stick around and always have its core fan base who actually buy. Because the new age stuff, you know, they're high on streaming, you know, just they'd rather run the numbers up on streaming, which there's nothing wrong with it, and a whole nother conversation. But to tap back into that whole, you know, the same with the resurgence of the vinyl, as you'd understand, Hamish, like, It's out there. People are just like, hey, for real? But even you know, we saw my one with the sales, and then obviously the Obies for this project for $333 sold out, you know, faster than the other ones, bro. Like, I thought there'd be a bit of a lag, you know, like we'll get eight of them sold or something, then the rest. But yeah, we probably could have did about 30 or 50 of them and they would have did well.
It's quite.
What have you, Richie?
Yeah. But I mean, it's like the whole. I mean, it's quite around. You see a lot more hip hop artists in this country using vinyl as a means to kind of get their music out, or as other sort of revenue streams. But I mean, like what with the release of Untitled, you know, Part One, and even you know, Golden Era as well. Like taking care in terms of the packaging, in terms of beyond what the music's actually telling you, giving you sort of control in terms of, hey, well, this is the price point, this is what, you know, the care in terms of the packaging and all that sort of stuff. It's quite refreshing to see, you know.
One is that, like, as you're aware, we're not signed, this wasn't done for a label, my album wasn't done for a label, so we couldn't advance the money there. So one reason is we bumped the price up that, for one, in the hopes that it will at least cover itself and cover costs. But then two, to have that whole art value where, I was just saying in a record, like the whole thing, there's a big difference between selling music and selling art, because music you can get for free on Spotify. So there's got to be an element where you're trying to reach the fans, or just to, sell an art piece. And like even my own, like with that, you know, I put one up of my black ones because people were saying, oh, they're selling my album for $600 to $1,200. So I tried it and put my one on Discogs, and in 10 minutes, someone in Aussie copped it for $300, just a standard black. So so it's out there, there's a demand on it, but there's really only a demand on price. And so obviously, the whole limited thing and stuff. You can be really creative as a independent, but obviously you got to put the work, hard work in background and, you know, make the sales. And
it's all buzzy to me too, because this whole vinyl culture is brand new to me. Like, I was oblivious that there was such a big market for it till Ricky had to put me up on game and school me. But it's awesome, like you said, it gives you it really pushes your ability to be creative and market it the way you see fit. It's been awesome.
Yeah, because that's what I was going to say. So it would have been, I mean, from recollection, like the only sort of record that you have on Wax might be like street rap.
Yeah, street rap.
Yeah. See, like the single of that. So it would be thing for a lot of fans that, you know, been following you over the years to have tangibility of like from a fan of, you know, collecting music on vinyl. It is that tangibility as well as being able to listen to it in that format as well, which is
what we didn't advertise, but we later did it just before I submitted the files to get printed, was the lyrics booklet.
Yeah.
So literally last minute, I was like, oh, Rex, have you got any of your lyrics written down and stuff? So we sort of compiled them and did a little cool, dope backdrop of the actual pages and then the digital print of the lyrics of the album. Just that whole hip-hop thing and the, like you said, the tangibility, the enjoyment of when you used to go check out who did the beats and who mixed it and mastered it and who was the executive producers, going through the notes and the thank yous. And so it's just really, like you said, putting a lot of care into it. We're not just trying to do it in, you know, like how most guys will just put a cover, white inner sleeve, and put it out, you know, like, so we try, as you saw with my album, we try to package it well. Yeah.
That's awesome.
We treat it as art, and people will retrieve it as art, though. They'll place that same value in it that we, you know, that we try and put into it.
Yeah. And what's sort of like, Mareko, in terms of like that sort of like tangibility of kind of those memories of certain albums, certain rap albums or any albums in general that like when you had it in your hands that you kind of spent time looking at? What? I don't know, it's what sort of albums were they? Like,
I used to read along to all the Public Enemy covers that, because they always had the lyrics in their albums. I remember I put a post on up on Insta about it, saying that reading along to Ice-T's Power, how he had the lyrics in there. Like that album was iconic just for the fact of him and as a DJ Evil D, oh no, not Evil D, Evil E, and his ex-wife at the time, maybe that iconic cover, but inside was also the lyrics and reading along to his track "Let's Get Butt Naked and Fuck." Oh shit!
Now you're good, man.
You edit that up, but yeah, it was just awesome. Like you said, reading the notes, also looking. I remember finding like the fan club addresses, you know, and always wanted to write to the. To the Ice-T fan club or the Chuck D fan club that was in the notes. It was, you know, if you're a real fan of the music, having that tangible art was awesome to have.
Yeah, and I'm sure like many others, like in terms of these releases, will feel the same way in terms of, you know, understanding in terms of, you know, the tracks on this project as well, is just feel more connected to yourself as a lyricist is.
Yeah, it's building that connection. You know, the market will be smaller, but the people that do appreciate it will really get it and really value it, value the effort and the time that we've put into making that. Yeah.
Yeah, because we put a lot into this, bro, where we actually, again, it may come across and it is costly, like, you know, or even a record now that we used to buy for $60 and now $80, you know, inflation and all that stuff. So, yeah, ours is definitely over $100, and then we have the premium ones for the $333. But for those guys who purchased that, we did a deal which they've all now officially now get. They own a percentage of the album. So from the sales, the streams and stuff, they actually get a revenue.
Oh, it's
the first of its kind for one. Probably the biggest selling album in terms of price-wise. Yeah. But also there's mad perks. They've also, next Friday, we have a big face call with everyone who purchased the vinyl, and they too can ask us. So we've made it really interactive. But also for those who purchased Act One and they go live with us, they get to choose who, you know, obviously they can't just go, you know, we want Kanye West on it. But like, they get to determine or give us submit names for who they want to hear with Mareko on Act Two.
Hey,
as the fashion,
and then cool process, hey?
Producers, if there's producers in there, they get to, if they've never had a collaboration or a placement at all, that they get the opportunity to co-produce alongside me for Act Three. So we've made, bro, like, to have a fan and go, bro, like, I'm on this album, a miracle, and you know, like, well, whatever, like, so we've just really thought the whole thing out and packaged it where it actually involves the fans, and we get to connect one-to-one with them rather than just, we made an album and hope you go buy it, you know?
Yeah, it, like, changes the whole, like, paradigm of how you release music or how people experience music, right, rather than, you know, just listen to, like you're saying, listening to it on streaming services and things like that. It's just kind of rewarding those sort of fans who want to have that, you know, deeper connection.
Oh, bro, like it is. Like me growing up, like if I could buy something like that from P Money, Dr. Dre, or even the Dawn Reed guys back in the days, that if I purchased their CD to be able to go meet them and go backstage or watch them make an album or even get the opportunity to give a beat to be on White Sunday, bro, I would have jumped at that. Yeah. But we've just, again, just making it more than music and making it more movement type of a thing and doing, but also doing something that hasn't been done in New Zealand anyway, so.
And I like the fact that, you know, it kind of like, this whole project kind of started with the fact that you kind of like crunch for time for your wedding, bro. I mean, like, you're like, hey, like Rex, here's some beats, and the majority of it's done, but what you've been able to do after that kind of bulk to kind of extend it to be, have longevity even before the release is pretty phenomenal, you know?
It's been cool, bro, and it's only the first one too, so laying the foundations is very important, but some people may not hear of it until Act Two or Three, and then their whole buzz just starts, bro, like, you know, like, bro, have you got Act One on vinyl? Like, they go back and start backtrack. We know it, bro, of like Tom Scott stuff, homebrew, now you have to pay $800 or $600 for vinyl. So like, that's gonna happen. But obviously, you know, Tom is the man in his craft, and he's good at that. He represses. We're not going to repress ours.
Yeah.
So it's going to go nuts for sure. Yeah. Today, it may happen in a year or three, but the craze will start.
Is that in terms of like Griselda, bro? Like in terms of, you know it, like you're probably now familiar with it, Mareko, in terms of like, you know, how the Alchemist or like a lot of Griselda jumped in on them. But it is a lot of it. Okay, I've got the one of
100,
you know, this is mine, you know, like.
Yeah, it's like adults flipping Pokemon cards.
Got to collect them all.
Yeah, I wasn't aware of, like, it just blew my mind how much Ricky was saying people were reselling Griselda vinyls for. I was like, nice.
I showed him some of the ones I sold of Westside, because obviously I had the Fly God and all that stuff, so I was able to get $6,000 US.
and I think people see that too, because
paid for something that I bought for $80. So like, it's just
A
lot of the guys that that actually purchased our vinyls don't even own record players.
Yeah,
they can, you know, they see the value in it, and it's crazy.
Oh yeah,
it's true, bro. Because it's the same with mine, Hamish. Like mine has got. I sold my last one this morning to a guy in Wyoming. From my pistol, I've got Obies left, and that's about it. But I don't know what to do with them, really. But Miracle's got one. But it's just amazing, bro. Like, it's just a cool thing. And we're not like here. Our motors, it's not so, you know, like we can bank off like $10,000. It's just. That's how art is. If you've got like my mate, you know, Owen Dippy, all these guys who are Charles Fat One, like when you've got a dope limited number piece and the demand's there, just good art can't help but not only sell itself but resell itself too. So
yeah, 100%.
Yeah.
And it gives more attention and focus to the project itself, right? Like in terms of hang on, this is a special moment. And the fact that it is like part of a trilogy as well. From something we're just like, hey, we've got like a little bit of time between like where we are now and, you know, the upcoming, you know, Decon's album.
Yeah.
Pretty phenomenal. Like, so outside of getting on wax, like how else are people able to listen to it? Is it just exclusively on vinyl, or is it gonna be dropping on like, you know, all that kind of normal stuff on this Friday?
This Friday. Yeah.
It'll be on all still on all the traditional streaming platforms.
Yeah.
And like, correct me if I'm wrong, you've got INF Davola.
Yeah. Well. INF on our lead single, What Are They Saying? It's called a collab with him and the bro Davola. He's also on there. So yeah, bit of the old and the new.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, that's awesome. Yeah. Well,
that single comes out soon. They just the video's literally been wrapped up now today.
Yeah.
Sweet.
That's probably the track in some ways that will, for the guys expecting the White Sunday, will be a little why that song. But for the new guys, like in terms of reaching, they'll get the whole groove and time signature of it and be like, yeah. Can you remember when I met, not to name drop, but Cuddy when he was here at the New Zealand shoot for his movie?
I mean, you were saying that a while back,
like 2-3 years ago. Kid Cuddy, well, that was the beat. The beat that you'll hear Mareko and INF on is the beat that I've actually got his hook on and him mumbling on it, but I'm not allowed to obviously release it, so.
Hey, you didn't tell me that, man.
You've got to
read down his book.
You'll hear it, Hamish, the moment you press play and go, oh,
I could see it, As someone who likes Cuddy, bro, like, I'm looking forward to hearing that, bro. It's going to be awesome.
And we'll send it to you too, so you can
Your
rotation.
And you just
run the numbers up, you know, have it on
repeat. We can do whatever you want. But no, I'm looking forward to everyone else being able to hear this come Friday. And it's just pretty cool just to like be able to chop it up with you guys and, you know, just kind of like hear, especially the exciting news and new Decons album, man. Like,
yeah.
Off of that.
Oh, man.
Shot for that, like, you know, a bit of an exclusive on that one. That's exciting. And I know a lot of people are going to be quite amped to hear that as well.
Yes, for me.
Yeah. Not that it's like overly that surprising because of how much you have been, like, in recent times, like, being kind of working together with Ricky as well, and kind of the energy surrounding a lot of the artists in that sort of, in that earlier Dawn Raid era, kind of keep releasing music as well. So,
yeah. And this sound is different to the Decons one as well,
yeah.
In terms of the overall sonic. So, yeah, like, yeah, don't expect what you hear on this one on the Decon. Oh, well, you can.
Two totally different feels.
Yeah, two different feels.
This project and the Decons album is two totally different feels, but equally as dope.
Yeah, just a chance for you to really, like, you know, get your raps off.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then MC was awesome to, you know, bar off.
Yeah.
And Ricky definitely provided some dope backdrops for that.
Yeah, that's awesome. Sweet. Well, everyone who's listening to us now, go and come Friday, check out on streaming services. But they can also, if you are still vinyl copies left, they can head up both yourself and Mareko to kind of see.
Yeah, just DM us, guys, and if you can, try get in before next Friday so you're able to purchase and make the live stream with Mareko and I. So there's only black and red left. The black, sorry, Hamish, but the black is $111. We couldn't come up with a price, to be honest. I just said, let's do 111.11222.22.
Yeah.
So, and the 180 gram transparent red is 222, and that's signed by Mareko and I. So those are the only two colours left. The other ones sold out quite quick.
Sweet. Mm. Well, anyone who's out there listening who is fan of New Zealand hip hop, also vinyl as well, and just good sounding music in that era, in for a treat, and definitely hit up both of you in terms of getting more of that tangibility. It's good to see. That's awesome. But I want to thank you both for hopping on Bass Breakfast this morning. It's going to be quite a cool chat for people to like be able to like tune into. Hope you enjoyed it all out there. And yo.
Thanks.
Yo.
Thanks, Bass FM. Thanks,
Bass FM. Golly.